It's nice to be here. It's nice to be anywhere at this time of the year, actually. But I'll be going back tonight after a bit of a trek. And what's the joke, Mark? What's the difference between God and Steve Wheeler? Isn't it? The difference is that God is everywhere. Steve Wheeler is everywhere but Plymouth. It's the old, you know the joke. Yeah, you've done a variation on it. It's usually Mark Brown, actually. Yeah. And that's the difference between God and Mark Brown. So... Here's the kind of the opening slide for you, and hello to everyone on streaming as well out there. I don't know how many of you are out there, but hello to both of you anyway. And this is really kind of what I'm interested in. I'm interested in digital learning. I'm interested in new pedagogies. I'm interested in the theories and the practice and how they combine. So the praxis, if you will. But I'm mostly interested in what my students do. So I thought today I'd try and give you the student voice. I've got several videos I'd like to show you in the time we've got available of them talking about what they're doing to make change happen. And I think it goes without saying that a lot of my students do stuff which I don't ask them to do. They go the extra mile. They go beyond my expectations every time. In fact, I think it was Stephen Heppel that said last year or recently, he said, give young people digital tools and they will astound you. They will amaze you. And I think we've got to understand that that is true in many, many different contexts, not just in teacher education, but also in primary, right the way through to lifelong learning. I think we've got to give young people the opportunity to express themselves. They've got the tools already. We've just got to give them the opportunity and they will astound us with what they do. They will amaze us with the amount of stuff that they can come up with and learn. One of the things I practice at my own university, I think you've probably heard of the flipped classroom. You've probably heard of Aaron Sams and his mate Bergman. Sams and Bergman came up with the idea that flipped classroom, they didn't come up with it, it's been going for years because we've been giving homework for years. But the point is, I want to go beyond that. I want to flip the roles. I want to flip the role of the teacher and the student. So I say to my students, okay, I know you want to learn from me, but I also want to learn from you. Can we make a contract here and now that we learn from each other? And they look at me all strange. And I give them projects where they go off and I ask them to come back and teach me something I don't know. You heard me. Teach me something I don't know. And they said, but this is impossible. I said, no, it's not, because all of us know something, but none of us know everything. So go off and find out something in that theory there or that idea there and come back and teach me something I don't know. And I become their awkward student. And I ask the awkward question. I ask the devil questions to make them think harder. And then the discussion that occurs from that and the amount of learning and reading that goes on after that point, I think is a kind of a secondary thing, but it's really important because it really works. So the pedagogy that we're doing, I think, in Plymouth, several of my colleagues doing the similar thing there, is trying to flip the whole thing on its head and get them to learn stuff which is not inside the teacher's head. And I put it to you that actually it doesn't matter where you teach, whether you're teaching in tertiary education, primary or secondary or lifelong learning, whatever you're doing, there's an opportunity for you to get them to learn stuff which is new and nobody's heard of before. In Amsterdam on Monday, I was speaking to a group of teachers there, all primary school teachers, and they said, how can this possibly be true? And I showed them a video by a psychologist called Bo Lotto. Has anyone heard of him? Yeah. TED Talks Bo Lotto. Look it up. It's a fabulous video. Because what he did was he went into a Devon school, and I know the head teacher verified this. I worked with him. This guy went into this Devon school, and he got involved with a whole load of children. I think they were in year 5 or year 4. So they were about, I don't know, 9 or 8 years old. And they did some research with honeybees. And they came up with completely new findings that nobody else had ever done before. And they subsequently published those in a scientific peer-reviewed journal. Have a look. Check out the TED talk and it'll explain the whole thing to you. Now, that is the first time that's ever happened. But I think it's not going to be the last. I think learning is learning is learning no matter what the sector you're in. The pedagogy's changed, but the point is that everyone can learn new things which nobody has learned before. It's creativity with a big C, not a small C, that we're looking at here. But here's the first problem we've got. And I often show this because I want to impress upon people that, look, we are in a particular situation now where change is so fast, it's so exponential, that we cannot clearly describe the future. We cannot describe the world of work that our students are going to go into in two or three years' time, let alone 10 years' time. We don't know what the new jobs are going to be, but we know they're going to be different. My son is doing a degree in games design. If I'd said to my teacher when I was at school, I'm going to be a games designer, he would have asked me what kind of goalposts I was going to design, or how big my footballs were going to be, or whatever, you know? Things have changed, concepts change. We've got to be really circumspect with this, but we've also got to be daring at the same time. There's a balancing act here going on. The point is, how can we prepare young people for a world of work that we don't even know exists yet by just giving them facts and knowledge? What we count is the answer. Facts and knowledge are no longer enough. We now need to look at new skills and new literacies. And many of the skills and literacies that I'm going to talk about are stuff which we know about already, but stuff which will give young people an advantage when they go into the world of work later on and they try and solve problems which haven't even been thought of yet. Especially problems that are brought about by the new technologies that are about to come into the world. Every technology brings new problems with it. And of course those technologies often need new solutions. So we're in a conundrum. This is an invidious position that teachers are in. How do we prepare young people for something which we can't even clearly describe? Albert Einstein talks about this concept, and I think it's right. This is what I subscribe to. We must create conditions which are conducive for creative and productive and critical learning. The great story about Einstein, which I'll tell, I've told this many times before, but I'll tell it to you because it illustrates a really key point about knowledge, the nature of knowledge. Einstein was invited to go and speak in America, and it was in an early part of his career when people didn't really know what he looked like, but they knew about his theory, and they invited him across, and he went across on the steamship to America. And he was assigned a driver who drove him from venue to venue and hotel to hotel. And the driver would always sit in the back with his cap on and his hat and in his coat. And he would sit in the back while Einstein was on the stage giving his speech. And then he would take him to his hotel and then on they would go. And after about 10 times of hearing Einstein give the same speech word for word for word for word each time, he was driving into his venue and he said, do you know, Professor Einstein, I've heard your speech so many times I could probably do it myself. And Einstein said, well, be my guest. I could do with the rest. And the driver said, what do you mean? He said, well, why don't we swap clothes? I'll sit in the back dressed as a chauffeur and you get on the stage and read my speech for me. I could do with an evening off. And so the driver thought about it for a minute and thought, my minute of fame, I'm going to do it. And they swapped clothes and Einstein sat in the back dressed as the chauffeur with his coat and his hat on. And the driver got into Einstein's suit and gave a word-perfect rendition of the special theory of relativity. Rapturous applause, everyone stood up, standing ovation. And the driver thought, this is great, I could do this, you know. And then he realized he was in trouble because they said, are there questions from the floor? And so the first question came from an eminent professor in the front row who asked a question which went right over the chauffeur's head. He didn't have a clue how to even interpret it, let alone answer it. But quick as a flash, he said, thank you for your question, professor, but I'm afraid it's so simple, even my driver at the back could answer. Two types of learning, you see? You've got the surface type of learning, which we learn by rote, we learn by repetition, we learn by just absorbing it, by copying, imitation. But the deeper type of learning, which the driver had to call upon to answer a problem and to solve a challenge which he had not anticipated, this is the deeper stuff that happens a lot lower down. It takes time, it's mastery, it's a kind of learning that we would call, I suppose, wisdom, if you like. But there's a third type of learning that Martin and Sally also identify, strategic approaches to learning, where you can rapidly switch between the two. And it's that kind of learning, really, that is the wisdom. This is the kind of learning which we're seeing students start to apply when they need to solve problems which are unfamiliar. And if you like, you can talk about all of it as knowledge, but it's the middle one, really, which I would like to identify as wisdom. And I'm suggesting to you that actually this is the kind of learning, the critical types of learning, which really will allow students to address problems in the future, which we cannot really clearly describe. So here's a kind of a map of it. So knowing that, knowledge is knowing that, it's declarative. Okay, whereas wisdom, I suppose the knowing how, the know-how if you like, and that's much more procedural. Whereas transformation is knowing why, it's critical. And if I put up on the left hand, on the right hand side, you'll probably notice that this is all kind of reminiscent of Bloom's taxonomy, which I'm sure you're all familiar with. I'll let you take a few pictures of it, because that's the modern ecology, isn't it, of learning, taking pictures. That's your way of making notes, yeah? This is a kind of another shift that happens. I explained this earlier on, this kind of pyramidal structure, where it's like, almost like a computer structure, but I think it's a lot more complex than this. This is a simplistic version of it, where engagement, student engagement, kind of goes down through these levels. You start off with facts, and then they become knowledge, and then the knowledge becomes application, then the application becomes wisdom, and eventually you're in a transformatory position where you never really want to go back from where you were before to where you were before. A tomato is a fruit. That's knowledge. Right, it's a fact, isn't it? A tomato is a fruit. Anyone want to disagree with that? In Amsterdam on Monday, someone said, no, it's a vegetable. And everyone went, what? You know, but for most people, a tomato is a fruit. That's a fact. Okay? Knowing you don't put it in a fruit salad is wisdom. But knowing why you don't do that, that's critical. How many of you could actually tell me why you don't put a tomato in a fruit salad? Anyone? Because your grandmother never did. So it was always thus, you see. So tradition comes into it in a big way. So does culture. This is a cultural implication here we're talking about. But anyway, just an idea for you to think about. So I'll borrow from Leven-Wenger here. Communities of practice. The theory that there are lots of different members in a community. And some of them are more peripheral than others. When you're on an online environment and you set up an online page, you'll notice that some students engage fully, others kind of engage sporadically, and there are some that don't engage at all. They just sit there and lurk. Have you noticed that? And you try and bring them into the center, but sometimes it's very difficult to do so. It's very difficult to kind of bring them to that place where they can become a full member and then even a core group member of the community. And there's been a lot of work done around this, not just from Corrales, but from others as well. So, for instance, Jack Marizov, transformatory learning, transformative learning. He says it involves a deep structural shift in our thoughts, feelings, and actions. It's a complete permeation of our psychology and our being. And if you really want a summary of that, I think it's in three areas. Self-concept, belief systems, and lifestyle or behavior. And I was examining a PhD, I think it was a year ago, at Hull University, a guy called Kevin Burden, and he came up with an idea that actually there is a particular event horizon. It's a bit like a black hole, you know, it sucks you in. And when students get to this point where they suddenly become a full member and then a core group member, they never ever want to go back again. There's no return from that point where they've been transformed. That's when they become professionals. That's when they take on that professional ethos. That's when their professional identity emerges. How do we get them to that point? This is the big question. So this is what we understand of higher education. It's always been this way. Do you see this when you teach? Rows upon rows, like we've got now actually, but usually in tears. I don't mean, you know, like that. I mean, in growing up like a raked classroom. I'm going to be doing this tomorrow. 9 o'clock tomorrow, I'm speaking to my 200 second years. They'll all be doing this. Actually, they'll be doing this. Because most of them are connected. They'll have their handouts, handhelds out, or they'll have their iPads, or they'll have their blinded by the apples. You see, what we've got here is not much of a change from that to that, but what we've got here now is a personal window on the world. What we've got is each student now has a personal window. Each student can actually question what's being said. They can be critical. They can start asking the what if questions and the why questions, and they can do it via Google or any other tool they wish. They can even send messages to each other and ask questions and discuss. They can even play Game Boy if they want, whatever they like. But if they're on task, they'll be probably thinking about what's being said at the front or what's being discussed, the reading that they've got to do. I have Twitter walls in my classroom. Does anyone do that? I have a live Twitter feed. I use real tweets or visual tweets or something like that, and it's a dynamic system, and it's a screen right next to my other screen where I have slides and so on. And this is a true story. A couple of years ago, two of my students were discussing a set reading that I'd given them, a book they had to read, and they mentioned the author. And of course, they're using a hashtag which is unique to the classroom that I'm running at the time. Now, the thing is, that's an open tweet because anybody can read it if they're tuned into either what I'm tweeting out or the hashtag itself. So it just so happened that these students were discussing this author and this book. And they had a question and they put it up onto Twitter. And I saw it on the screen behind me, so I retweeted it. And I retweeted it knowing full well that the author actually follows me on Twitter. He's in America. And so I thought I knew what would happen, and sure enough it did. Within 20 minutes he was actually on Twitter answering the question from the students direct, and you can see their faces, they went. And they were animated and they were so thrilled. For a few minutes they didn't answer him, but then one of them asked me, is that who we think it is? I said, yes it is. And they were so amazed, and then they were inspired by what he was saying to them, and they were having a direct connection with that author. Can you imagine how inspirational that is, how motivational that is for students? This is the kind of stuff we should be doing now. It's bringing, not just going out into the world with your tools, but bringing the world into the classroom as well. It's about breaking down the walls, the barriers, the false frontiers, as I call them, that contain us. It's about allowing students to bring in the tools that they want to use, which they are intimately familiar with, and you don't need to train them, and for them to gain access not just to the content that you're providing them, but content from around the world and conversations and other artifacts and so on, experiences from everywhere. I think this is the paradigm shift that's going on in education now. And it's also about this. I know this looks strange, doesn't it? But actually, that could very well be my father there. My father's 87 now. And that could be my daughter on the other side, although she's now 20. She's actually 22. But when she was 18 and he was 84, I convinced him to get onto Facebook. I said, what do I want to use Facebook for, buddy? I said, well, you know, think about this. You can send photographs to your niece in New Zealand. I have a cousin in New Zealand. Mark knows about this. I have a cousin in Mount Wellington in Auckland. And he hasn't seen her for 40 years. The last time he was out there was 40 years ago. And I said, you can send photographs to her. He said, but I do that every year in the mail at Christmas time. I said, but how long does it take to get there, Dad? Could be a week. I said, you can do this in seconds. Take a photograph and she sees it in seconds and vice versa. She can send you pictures of her grandkids. Oh, I'll have a go at that, he said. So we had a go at it. Oh, this is marvellous. And he looked around to see who he could friend. And he friended my daughter. And her first reaction was on status update, WTF, Granddad's on Facebook. And of course, he doesn't know what WTF is, so he asks her what WTF is. So her response is, welcome to Facebook. Of course it is, isn't it? What else would you say? But the trouble is he now uses it with his friends as well. You know, so it's, welcome to Facebook. You know, it's WTF, Vicar, you know? You know, it's one of these memes that happens. But what I'm trying to say to you is, look, there's this differential that goes on between older and younger people when they're using the same space. And we've got to be so careful about the way we interpret the actions and the words of each other. It's not an easy thing when you're sharing the same space with multiple generations. So there are organizations in this country now who have three generations possibly working side by side using the same digital space. So I think we have to be careful about the way we use these tools. I want to show you a video which talks about perceptions, actually. And hopefully we'll get the sound right on this and you'll be able to see this.
This is the end of publishing and books are dead and boring. No longer can it be said that we like to read. My friends and I, we don't like the way books feel in our hands. It's not true that I don't follow trends. I know what I want when I see it, and packaging is more important than content. I have to tell you, my attention span is too small for big ideas. And it's just not true that I read a lot and I like learning. I don't care. and you should never think I've got to be concerned with environment and sustainability. What I really hope you get is you've got to open your eyes to my values. What's important to me is what Lady Gaga is wearing, and I don't really care all that much what Gandhi did last century. I think it's unbelievable that you're actually listening to us. What's important for you is you'll find customers for your products. You think your job's done if we like your brand. We'll do it for you on Facebook, on our mobiles, me and my friends. Your market is dying. Don't think it's all going to survive. It is the end of the publishing industry as we know it. Unless you reverse how you see me. It is going to survive. Don't think that it's all dying. Your market is me and my friends. On our mobiles, on Facebook, we'll do it for you. If we like your brand, your job's done. You'll think of products for your customers. You'll find what's important for you is that you're actually listening to us. I think it's unbelievable what Gandhi did last century. And I don't really care all that much what Lady Gaga is wearing. What's important to me is you've got to open your eyes to my values. What I really hope you get is I've got to be concerned with environment and sustainability. And you should never think I don't care. I read a lot and I like learning. And it's just not true that my attention span is too small for big ideas. I have to tell you, content is more important than packaging. I know what I want when I see it and I don't follow trends. It's not true that we don't like the way books feel in our hands. My friends and I, we like to read. No longer can it be said that books are dead and boring and this is the end of publishing.
So, you see, it's about perception. It's about how we view each other. And I'm afraid I don't subscribe to this digital natives and immigrants theory. If you want to debate it with me, I'm quite happy to do so. But there's no empirical evidence to support it. It's mainly conjecture. It's mainly supposition. There are much better theories out there that describe the way that people use technology. And I think we're doing a disservice both to the old and the young and all generations if we start defining people's use of technology by age alone, by generation. So if you ever hear the word digital natives or the expression digital immigrants, consider it just as an excuse to either shy away from technology or to blame it in the wrong direction. I think White and the Cornu's theory of visitors and residents is quite an interesting one. Visitors being those who are casual users of technology, and residents being those who habituate into a particular type of tool. So you could well be a resident on Twitter and only a visitor on Facebook. Doesn't make you a native or an immigrant. It makes you somebody who uses different technologies in different ways. And I think each of us have to find our own level. So going back to my slides, clearly we learn by doing. We learn by actually getting our hands dirty, by being involved. But we also learn by making. This is the theory of constructionism that I'm sure some of you are familiar with. And there's a lot of interesting research that's come out, not just in terms of things like Mindstorms that Papert did, but also things like Mitch Resnick did. There's recently been work around things like Minecraft and how it can be used powerfully to shape people's perceptions and to allow them to take concepts on board and learn them and understand them. So learning by making is important. This is a picture of my students. Two of them you'll see in a video in a moment. This is Aaron here with his back to you, and this is Alex over here. And they were first years when this happened, and I asked them to go away and study a theory and come back and present it to me and teach me something I didn't know. And what did they do? They went off and made a video. I didn't ask them to, but they went off and made a video because they felt that that was the best way that as a group they could express their learning. And I thought that was incredible, just to think that they were doing stuff, they were going the extra mile without me asking them to. It's about this. It's about certainly what we're now calling learning 2.0. I think this was Stephen Downes actually came up with this idea originally. Learning 2.0. It's a way that we can express a new paradigm or a new model of learning where people are actually creating their own content now. They're not just absorbing or accepting or receiving content or knowledge, then they're actually creating it themselves. And not only are they creating it, but they're also doing all these other things as well, like what we're going to see now. Okay, so this video was made by those two students I mentioned and a third one to explain at BET this year, or just gone, how they changed learning.
This recently came out of sort of school in sixth form and things, and I think the way that seems to work is that teachers provide a lot of the input and then we kind of respond to that, but going to university has kind of changed the way that's done in that it's a very much collaborative thing, so students obviously have a very strong voice in their own learning, and as well as teachers providing input, students can then question teachers as well, and lecturers, for example. On Twitter, that's a very good social network for having conversations on the back of what we've done in lectures and seminars. So I think that's a very more sort of rounded learning process.
Okay, personally, I always bring in my iPad to seminars and lectures because I'm able to bring up the PowerPoint, which is always made possible on our student portal, which is really useful because it holds all the information, all the notes from the seminars and lectures. So I always bring that up and make notes actually on the PowerPoint, so I've always got that saved. And I always use Evernote as well because I found that, especially during my assignments, I can just search all of the documents, all of the pictures that I've taken for particular keywords, and I can find information to be able to put it in afterwards.
Normally to a lecture, I bring my phone, I bring my iPad, I bring my laptop, and then I'll have like Twitter open on my phone, or have the PowerPoint open on my laptop so I can see the PowerPoint that we're doing in the lecture, and then I'll have on my iPad, I'll have just like going through Google and Google what the lecturer is saying, so I can like constantly find extra things to the lecture, so I know what's going on more so than what's actually being told in the lecture.
So you can see that they are actually going this extra mile. What they're doing is they're searching for extra stuff. They're drilling down farther. This is what we now start to call rhizomatic learning. Rhizomes are a particular, it's a botanical metaphor. The rhizomes are a kind of an underground root structure which growing any direction. There's no center to them, and there's no real periphery because they can go where they want to and find their own level. It's a bit like water, it'll find its own level. But the point is, that kind of is reminiscent of the way people are now using the web to jump around from hyperlink to hyperlink and to learn almost serendipitously, to learn through just asking the questions and going the next step and asking what if. And this is what these students are doing. So it's all of these tools are being used in this Learning 2.0 model. And it's often been said, you know, that in schools and in universities, we're still using Learning 0.1 or 1.0 to teach 2.0 students. And of course, they want to do this. This is something that they are very comfortable with doing. It's modeling on their, I suppose, their personal backgrounds as well, very much. Because this is what they do outside of university or outside of college or outside of school. And all of these tools and others can be quite powerful. I mean, curation, for instance, many tools like Scoop-It and Pearl Trees and, I don't know, Deagle perhaps, which allow you to take content which you've found and put it into a social space which other people can then find. But also you can add additional notes to it. You can annotate it. You can add comments to it. And this, I think, provides additional value. So it's more than just aggregating, it's curating. And this is what my learners certainly are becoming quite familiar with now. And they use it to make more sense of their learning. So Papert actually says this. He says, look, give them a chance to take charge of their own learning. And this here, I just wanted to point this out to you because students are actually discovering this is powerful as well. So you can imagine if this is a community of learners. This is actually a picture I took at in the top of the British Museum last year, and people were just milling around. And but can imagine this guy here, next to the yellow table here. Imagine if he connects to three people. Okay, that's the start of a network, but it's not really a network. It's three other people. There's four in the network. But if each of those are connecting to other people as well. Whoop, too far. If each of those are connecting to other people, suddenly you've got a huge network. And this is the idea of knowledge propagation. The idea that if you've got something and you want to share it, you share it on your professional or personal learning network, and it gets amplified and amplified and amplified outwards. That can be Twitter, that can be Google Hangouts, it could be Facebook, it could be any social media tool you wish. Whole point of this, and I'm sure this is happening on Twitter as we're speaking, there's probably a Twitter back channel where people are actually here and maybe watching online as well, who are tweeting out stuff that they're hearing here they find interesting, which goes out to a wider network of people, and before you know it, it reaches millions of people. This, in effect, is the start of global education. This is the start of people like you and me becoming global educators. We don't even have to leave our own classrooms to do so. We can do it through the tools we've got available to us. And I won't even start to talk about things like Creative Commons, because that in itself is an amplifier. That in itself is a means of propagating things much wider than they would go normally. I can stand here now and say to you that I publicly declared 2 years ago, actually 3 years ago now, that I would refuse in future ever to publish or edit or review for a closed journal ever again. I resigned from my position as editor of Interactive Learning Environments, and I spoke to the publishers and told them why. I thought it was unethical and also immoral that they should be charging twice for people to read the research. Publicly funded research should be open and free, but the publishers take it and they put it behind a firewall, paywall. And I think that's immoral. So I'm only now publishing in open access journals. I'm only reviewing and writing for open access journals. And when I put a Creative Commons license upon my work, it means that anybody can use these photographs for free. They can use my ideas for free. They can use my content for free. And not only that, they can repurpose them if they want as well. And because of that, I heard recently that several people have been translating some of my blog posts and slideshows into Spanish and French and German and Italian. When somebody took my posts and translated them into Spanish, suddenly my blog traffic, visitors traffic, went up through the ceiling, because suddenly the whole of Latin America was aware of my work and could read it. I didn't have to pay them to do that. In fact, I didn't even have to ask them. They didn't have to ask me for permission. They just did it. As long as my name's on it, it complies with the Creative Commons license. Secret is, give your stuff away for free. If you do that, you will not be disappointed, and you'll be educating people who really need it. This is the new ecology. It's about crowdsourcing knowledge, it's about building up your professional learning network, it's about making connections. It's about, if you like, storing your knowledge with your friends. This is connectivism. This is distributed cognition. This is all sorts of other leading and emerging theories of learning. Paragogy is the, I suppose it's peer learning, but it's learning on an equal level. It's not ZPD, it's not Vygotsky. In Vygotsky's theory, you have a knowledgeable other person. In this theory, everyone's knowledgeable. Everyone has something to offer. Everyone's on an equal level, on par. And with hurtagogy, the idea that Hazen Kenyon's idea, that in fact, we all know how to learn implicitly. It's just that we need to know what to learn and why to learn it. And hurtagogy is about self-determined learning. These theories, I think, are going to be increasingly important in the digital age as we move down through the years. And I'll show you another video. I'm going to intersperse this with several videos about what my students are doing. And then maybe we'll have a discussion at the end.
It's progressed through my first year, but it's specifically different from school life, because I'm able to use Twitter in lectures, for example, and there's always a stream going on in the background of all of us students talking to each other, and also sometimes the lecturers who are presenting are answering our questions at the same time as actually presenting, which is really useful, because for me, if I hear something, sometimes I'll forget it quite quickly, but if it's there on Twitter, I can always go back to that hashtag later. I know it will be there, and I can check what it was, and it's online, so you can always link, like hyperlink to other websites as well.
Well, it's helped me connect with people enormously. It's helped my knowledge become far more informed. I'm able to actually go into conversations that happen on social networks and actually contribute to them or just view them. there's been a few that recently that I've been part of that have really informed my learning. Also, I've really taken to blogging, and I've actually blogged my thoughts, and I've actually got some very good responses that have either just like sort of accredited what I've done or actually extended my thinking further by prompting me with questions.
So I'm dyslexic, so I get Metro Support University, which means I get like laptop software to help me do my assignments because I find it quite difficult to with the reading and the writing and the spelling kind of aspects of it. So I have like a software which allows me to mind map on my computer and create like expansive mind maps with my ideas of what I want to do, and I can take those and then expand them even further and then help me write my assignments with them. And I've also got a software called Dragon, which lets me talk to my computer and it types out for me rather than me having to type out myself, because that's easier for me to write my assignments that way than actually typing it.
So there's some more responses from the students on how they're using the technology to enhance their learning. I was in a debate once on a panel with two of my colleagues in front of all the students, and they both challenged me to give them an example of how technology had transformed learning. And so I just simply said to them, special educational needs. And they both went, okay, we surrender. There's no argument, is there? For most students, technology enhances their learning. For special educational students, like, you know, Aaron there, who's got dyslexia, severe dyslexia, it actually enables learning. Yeah. So I think that what we're looking at is a new cultural capital here. In Bourdieuian terms, cultural capital means it's the social glue, isn't it? But in these terms, we're actually looking at a new digital cultural capital. We're looking at how learners identify with each other and how they form their little tribes, how they create their communities. Really, it's through this mediation that they find their new cultural capital. Of course, the first mobile phones were huge, but now we're all using them. mobile phones have brought in a number of issues which a lot of my colleagues are kind of worried about, and here's the start of it. What is this, do you think? Does anyone know what this is? Shout it out if you know. It's obviously a Wordle map, you know that, but what is it of? You're close. It's actually Obama's inauguration speech from back along. When was that? And it's interesting because people are now using this for research. They're now using it to do discourse analysis and things like this, you know. It's incredible the things you can use these social tools for if you put your mind to it and think creatively. And of course, you know, that's just one example. But what about this here? What does this look like to you? Hey, you got it? That's the Lord's Prayer in text speak. And of course, text, as you know, has 160 characters. And of course, the Lord's Prayer is something like 240 characters. So it's about trying to squeeze it in. I think it was Victoria Carrington that calls this squeeze text. But there are other various versions of it. Non-orthogonal speech, I think, is one of them. Phonetic spellings in there, but this is just one example of the versions of the Lord's Prayer which were done by this organisation, the Ship of Fools, and they asked for people in a competition. It's 372 characters long, look, and 160 characters is what it had to be cut down to, so more than half. And that was the winner, but I think the second place one was better. I think it's this one's better. And you can do this in street language, you know, street talk, like our part in Evan, you know? In Evan, you know? Rescue us from the evil one, for you are always the most excellent dude. Yo! You know? I think to me, you know, this is very creative, isn't it? And yet, some of my colleagues, not just in my own university, other universities, they're saying, actually, surely this is dumbing down the English language, is it not? Surely if they practice this all the time and they're on squeeze text all the time and they're using their mobiles to text all the time with thumbs, signalling with their thumb, And surely that's going to transgress upon their essay writing and there's going to be problems. Actually, no, it's not, because I think students know the difference. What they do is they tend to switch their mode of writing from one mode to another. Sometimes you'll see phonetic spelling when they've made a mistake, but generally speaking, I think they know the difference, and I think we should be trusting them. I think there are lots of ways that this can be used creatively for learning. And I think we have to understand that, as Kurzweil says, change is not linear anymore, it's exponential now. And mobile phones, these tools that they bring into the classroom with them, these are actually growing exponentially. In fact, this is 2013, and look, it's about to cross over. There are now more mobile devices in the world, more mobile phone subscriptions than there are people. And that means that even although a third of the world's population probably has not got a mobile phone, that means that others of us probably have two or more. Who has two mobile phones on them in the room? Well, admit it, three, four of you. Hmm? That's interesting. I won't ask you what you do with the second one, but can you see? I mean, I asked once how many people had four, and there was even one person that put their hand up for four mobile phones on them in the room. So people use them for different purposes. And you can guarantee now that most of your students will have a mobile phone of some kind, and they'll probably be smartphones, they'll probably have cameras in them and GPS. The uses for these tools are still emerging. There are still huge possibilities that we haven't even thought of yet. Look at this here. This is from 2009 to 2014, and you can see as you go along the decline in certain things like TV, even online, look, radio, print, mobile. You can see what's going to happen, can't you? These are the trends. And this is what you're doing at the moment, taking notes. Now, there was a debate on Monday in Amsterdam about whether this is learning or not. Is this learning or not? And of course, the answer is it depends. Doesn't it? Depends on what you do with it once you've taken the picture. Now, what my students tell me they do is often they don't do much with it afterwards, but those who do actually do something afterwards with it, what they do is they usually share it with their friends, or put it into a slide, or they take it away and they embed it into a blog that they're writing. You'd be surprised how many of my students write blogs. There's a whole culture in Plymouth of students writing blogs. In fact, we've had to set up a website to capture them all. It's the Plymouth University or Plymouth University primary blogs site if you want to search for it. And you'll find dozens and dozens of students in there blogging regularly about what they're learning. So they will use photographs and images like this to embed within their blogs. This is a school in New Zealand called Taupaki School. It's Mark probably knows where this is. It's to the north of Auckland. And it's a primary plus school where the children there are from year one right up to year 8, I think it is, so year 8. So they're about 13 years old when they leave this school. And this little girl here, she's probably about 12 years old, 11 years old, and she is working with augmented reality. In fact, she's created a gallery of images, including self-portraits, and they're interactive. And she's done this because she's got the opportunity to do so. She's learning from it. There's another one here. This is a group of students who are creating things using Makey Makey. Who's heard of Makey Makey? You can turn any surface into a part of the touch surface that can activate a computer. So I've seen them creating keyboards out of bananas. They connect each banana up, and each banana, when you press it, plays a different tune, plays a different note. Here's another one here. The students here making robots that walk, and they're programming them. You've got Coda Dojo over here, haven't you? This is a similar version in New Zealand that they're using to program robots. I walked over to two students and they were using AutoCAD. Wow, computer-aided design. And I said to them, what are you doing? And they said, oh, we're learning maths. We're doing ratios at the moment. I said, so what are you learning here? And they said, well, what we've done is we've gone out and we've measured the whole school, all the grounds of the school and all the buildings, and now we're recreating it on AutoCAD to show that, you know, different ratios and the different angles and so on. And I thought, well, this is amazing. And they were only 11 years old. Can you see how this is transformationary? This is so different to the way we learnt when we were in school. It's about personalising learning as well. And this is just my own personal learning environment here. I don't use ePortfolios anymore, but I certainly use all these other tools. I'm sure you can recognise some of them. Each of our personal learning environments that we bring into the room with us are different. Everyone's different, and therefore the tools you will use will be different. Some of my students recently made a video, three of them made a video, talking about their personal learning environments. And each of them showed how, although they had some in common, most of the uses were different. And they also showed that actually the learning environment is not just the web tools, it's the surrounding context as well that you use, including these here. Excuse me, that was my stomach. We had a big lunch earlier on, it's Mark's fault. And you can see here that it's not just the web tools, it's the whole of the personal learning network that you have, but it's also the wider elements of this, like realia. Realia for me is real experiences. My biggest experience in school, the thing that made the most of me, was I was at school in Holland, and we took a day trip up to Eindhoven to the Philips Flying Saucer. Anyone heard of that? The Philips Flying Saucer is a building made in the shape of a flying saucer. You go up in a glass lift, and you go to the top, and you work your way down around in a spiral all the way down to the base. And it was the history of technology. And in there, they had some amazing new technologies. And bearing in mind, this was 1970. Star Trek had just come out. And we were watching Captain Kirk and Mr. Spock talking to each other over video. And I'm thinking, wow, this is amazing. And we got to try it out for ourselves. They had two rooms there. And one had a camera and a microphone and a TV in it. And so did the other one. And you could sit in one room and pull funny faces at your mates down the corridor. And I thought, this is amazing. It switched me on to technology. I thought, I've got to do this for the rest of my life. And here I am. But the point is, realia is about going out and making connections with the real world as well. And technology gives us the ability to do this, especially the tools that the students are bringing in with them. And often I get asked, okay, isn't personal learning a contradiction to social learning? And I say, no, not really, actually, because you can do both at the same time. Imagine this family in the 1950s, and they're all watching the same TV channel, because that's all there is, basically. One TV channel, and when it's 10 o'clock, it blinks out to a little white spot, doesn't it? And then the national anthem plays and you all go to bed. Yeah? Remember that in the 1950s, those of you who were around then? Yeah? And the thing is, they all had the same experience. This was a social event, but they were all in the same family together and they all had the same experience. And you could go into work the next day and say, oh, did you see that program on telly last night? And everyone would have seen it. Not anymore. There are now thousands of channels. Our experience has become atomized. Atomized to the extent that everyone's watching something different. But take this same kind of family and fast forward them to 2014, and we are family. Now you notice that they're still gathered around a TV screen, but now something has happened. They're all having individual experiences because each of them in their hand is a personal device. And that personal device can not only control it, gives them feedback as well. Ever tried the Wii handset? Tried a golf swing? If you hit, that was a cricket shot actually. If you hit the golf ball too hard, not only do you hear it's gone wrong, you see it's gone wrong, but you also feel it in your wrist, don't you? It vibrates in a strange way. This is the feedback and control mechanism now that you have in your hand when you're using mobile phones. And that's why I think that personal and social learning can work together. And here's another theory for you to think about. I'm rushing through these theories and ideas so that we've got time to discuss. And I might just stop in a minute and give up on the slides. But I like this theory. It's an important one because it actually shows you why and how you can become so absorbed in something that you forget to eat or sleep, which is where we need to try and get students when they're learning. We need to keep them on task and we need to keep them so zoned in that learning has become the most important thing for them. And Csikszentmihalyi's theory here is quite an interesting one because you're talking about skills on one axis and challenges on the other. And he talks about this fact that actually, the flow channel is a balance between anxiety and boredom. If your skills are high, but the challenge is low, you get bored. If, on the other hand, your skills are low and the challenge is high, you get anxious. So what he's saying is that we might start at P1, but we might veer off into P2 or P3. And what we need to do is keep going back up through to keep within the channel. And that means that any design of technology, whatever it's conveying in terms of content or games or social media or whatever, it should have an equal challenge that rises commensurate with the skills that are being developed. And often this is where we get digital learning wrong, because the challenge becomes too high for the skills, or the skills are outstripping the challenge. And challenge-based learning, problem-based learning, which, whatever you want to call it, is probably one of the most powerful ways of changing people's minds. So I think the old theories, like Csikszentmihalyi's theory from 1991, a long time ago, but still very valid today, and in fact increasing in its kind of credence and cadence as well. This theory here, which you all know about, Vygotsky's theory, zone of proximal development. I'm going to start taking some risks here and mashing it all up here. Can you imagine that there are three zones, and it's the second zone that we're most interested in, because the third zone's out of reach. But the second zone is where you learn more from other people. I would suggest to you it's not just knowledge of others, but it's also technology and tools now that's making the difference. They're also starting to scaffold how we learn. Clearly there's a social element behind it, because there are people behind the YouTube videos that you learn from, or people behind the social media. But generally speaking, the technology and the tools start to mediate this zone of proximal development now. And if you overlace that on the Csikszentmihalyi theory, you can see that there's a potential for that flow channel and that zone of proximal development to equate together to such an extent that actually, if you scaffold it properly, you can probably reduce the boredom and the anxiety. And that's just a theory, and I haven't tested it, and maybe someone else will go away. Maybe if I get some time, I might just do some research on it. But that is my current thinking. And David Jonathan, who I once had the honour to spend a week with in Turkey, he's sadly no longer with us, but David Jonathan talks about mind tools. I call them cognitive technologies. Mind tools, the same thing. They amplify your skills, they amplify your capabilities, as the students have shown you today. They make things possible which were never possible before. So one more video to show you. Same students. This time, what innovation and what changes have they brought to higher education? This is their opinion.
With the, as for the change in them, if you get like a student body, so like course reps for the course, they can talk to the rest of the course, and then they can feed back to the lecturers what they're not like on the course. So last year, myself and one of my friends were course reps, and we asked our friends what they didn't like about the course, and then they told us that they didn't like the choice of assignment, what modes we had. So we had to do like three, so we had two choices of doing essays and one doing like a poster, and we could only do that one that year and we couldn't do it the next year. So we had that changed by the university, so we could then pick the modes we wanted to do rather than just that.
Students in our cohort year group have been using Facebook, and a group in particular, for any concerns or advice that anyone wishes to have. And what this does is that it's actually a student-led group, so we all talk to each other, we help each other out on any difficulties with assignments, or if there's any events coming up that we want to like advertise. And it's really useful, because obviously lecturers can sort of be in the background, but then they can come in and help with any questions as well. And I think using Facebook's probably a more effective method than, say, emails, because Facebook is obviously much quicker. People can get back to you within seconds, and in our sort of generation, Facebook's used a lot more than emails. People see emails as quite a sort of a time-consuming thing to have to log on to do. So
there you are. So it's interesting that the first student, Aaron, actually talked about a choice in format. I actually unilaterally took a decision 2 years ago to change the format of the essay to other formats. And so I said to my students at the start of the term, I said, okay, this year you don't have to write an essay unless you want to. You have to write a 4,000 word essay or equivalent. So the equivalent could be a video or it could be a blog. And several of the students actually decided to do a blog, and one actually made a video. And the flack that I got from my admin staff when they submitted, they said, we want a printout, because the external examiner needs a paper-based printout. I said, yeah, okay, so how are you going to print out a video? How are you going to print out a blog and keep all the hyperlinks intact? And they said, but the external examiner is going to go up the wall. So give me the phone. I rang them, picked up, rang Danny external. You're all right with this, Fred? You know, absolutely. Right, okay. And they ran out of excuses in the end, and they had to allow it to happen. Sometimes you have to take risks. You have to be a positive deviant and make some changes. When you run up against the innovation prevention department, because every department has one, you sometimes have to hit them head on and say, I'm going to do a change here, and I don't care what the consequences are. Subsequently, many students are now submitting blogs or videos as part of their assignment. And I have to say that it's been a huge success, because some of them can express themselves better in that way. I think the trick is to give them lots of possibilities, so they have to try all the options. And then they become multi-literate. Then they're not just writing an assignment, they're also expressing themselves through video, they're expressing themselves through a podcast, they're expressing themselves through blogs and so on. And they're also entering into dialogue with colleagues and friends and people that they don't know as well. New learners are all these things, says Waters. But I think they need a lot more than that. I was talking this morning about it. That's not a real picture, by the way, just in case you thought that. I was talking this morning to a group of staff at St. Patrick's. I think you were there, weren't you, Yuta? And I mentioned to them then that actually we leave a legacy when we do these selfies. We take pictures of ourselves in all sorts of situations. And some of those we might not want our grandmother to see, let alone people who are about to give us a job and they want to interview us, and they Google us and find out what we're like, and then they see these pictures of us. And I think this is a kind of a digital reputation thing going on here. But I show my students this and I say, what do you think this is? What's the problem here? And they go, ooh, what's the problem? And one student actually said to me, she said, is it 70%? And so I said, no, actually, you know, this is 60%. She said, well, that's not Thomas Edison. And I said, yes, it is. And it took her 40 seconds to work it out, actually. You see, the thing is, if it's on the internet, it must be true. I found it on Wikipedia. It must be true. So there needs to be a kind of a critical awareness, I think, that students need to have. So it's not just about digital reputation management, it's about critical thinking. And there's a whole range of digital literacies that I think we can talk about here. Here's some of them. This is not exhaustive. There are many, many others, but these are some of the important ones, I think, that you'll see right up front when students start learning in an institution like a university. These are the things that they need to learn to do to survive and to thrive. And that's to say there are many others. You see, the thing is, skills are one thing. I learnt to drive in England, on the left-hand side of the road. You learnt to drive in Ireland, left-hand side of the road. What happens when you go to America? You have to drive on the left-hand side of the car, the right-hand side of the road. You have to follow different road signs, the different conventions. It's easy to drive in Ireland or England, but America, I went over there and I made lots of mistakes. I really hacked off some of the drivers, you know, because there are unwritten conventions, aren't there? See, the competencies that I developed, the unconsciousness, you know, I drive to work every day and I don't remember. Scary. Unless something critical happens, like a cat runs into the road and I accelerate. No, I brake. But the thing is, when something like that happens, you suddenly think consciously. But if not, you're thinking unconsciously. And this is a competency. We need to get to the point where we can interpret these competencies in any environment, even if the problems are unfamiliar. So we need literacies. So literacies are our ability to be able to interpret and perform our skills and our competencies in strange environments like the digital environment, which for many of us is alien, just like going to America to drive. And finally, you should reach mastery. And there's the pyramid complete. Take your pictures now. But that's just kind of an example of the progression through to the point where you become digitally fluent or digitally literate. There are also the four C's, which I'll briefly talk about. Remember the three R's? Reading, writing, and arithmetic. The four C's, Mark Federman's idea. There's connection, there's context, there's complexity and connotation. And those four, he says, are equally important in the digital age. These are the things we need to be mastering now if we're going to be prominent and effective in a digital world. And I'll just briefly go through each of them with you. No, I won't. I will go briefly through each of them with you. Essentially, things like complexity is the ability to be able to apply your skills in really strange environments and to interpret complex things in very simplistic ways so that you understand them. And connotation is meaning-making. But I think I've done enough for the day. I think I've given you enough food for thought. So I'll just leave you with that thought there, which is a wonderful idea from a guy with an appropriate name. And that's my ethos for teaching as it stands. And these slides are available. They will be available afterwards. I'll leave a copy with you, Eamon and Mark. Okay. So, and those are my contact details. Thank you very much.